Hello everyone, Vanessa here again from Humans of Beekeeping, and today with me I have the famous Parliament beekeeper, Mr. Cormac, in live from Canberra. Do I say it right?
yeah, you said it right. It's unusual. Usually people bugger it up. So.
Awesome. I met Cormac. Actually, the first time that I got in contact with Cormac, actually, Cormac contacted me in regard of the World Bee Day that has happened last year, in regard of getting your hands onto honey from South Australia. And then after that, went around Australia, and you were one of the only person apart from Sobin. That I wanted to meet. So I was very glad to meet you in November last year, and I was very lucky to open the hives at the Parliament House in Canberra. Yeah. So can you explain a little bit more about yourself and tell us who you are?
Yeah, so I'm an environmental scientist. That's my main job. I specialize in bushfire protection engineering, but primarily I'm a botanist. And that's how I got into bees. I've always been interested in native bees because they're a critical pollinator for Australian native plants. But I got into beekeeping about, I think it's about 6-7 years ago now. It'd be 6-8 years ago now. We ended up, we purchased a house and we had this beautiful apricot tree and it just wouldn't fruit at all. So the fruit wasn't setting properly. And as a botanist, I could look at that and go, I know what that is. That's insufficient pollination. We'll get a hive of bees. And from there away it went. So I ended up, in terms of beekeeping, I've been president of the local association for a couple of years, which was fun and exhausting. I've been one of the organisers for World Bee Day, helping out the Slovenian embassy and other embassies organise that. But the thing most people know me for is being the head beekeeper for Parliament of Australia, which is still the strangest job I've ever had to do. So probably the second strangest job. Sorting through the entire trash of 7 army bases is definitely still the strangest job I've ever had to do.
Oh, wow. you just say that was being the president of the local club was hard? Why?
Yeah, just managing all the different personalities. As you know, the biggest challenge with beekeepers is if you ask 5 beekeepers, you know, what to do about a given situation, you'll get about 10 different mutually exclusive approaches, which they all furiously argue with. So managing all of that and managing the interaction between very experienced beekeepers who are sometimes very set in their ways and completely new beekeepers, it was a time of real change. It was when that wave of new beekeepers really hit, and all the clubs were finding to varying degrees difficulties in managing that. We were really, really lucky in that the local ACT government had given us a fantastic training apiary. We were able to establish around 20 hives, all different configurations, including flow hives, top bar hives, waray hives, all these different hive types, including native bee hives as well, for solitary bees. Mm-hmm. And we're able to showcase that and take people through an actual look and feel. So our training courses now are working really well. We've got a really good training manager. And so people get, before they buy a hive, we're getting people turning up to these training courses. I think we trained like 150, 200 people last year.
They get to open
all different hives and see what they're actually going to be doing. And then you'll find they make much better choices as to which hive to start with. But that was the thing is we went from about 150 members to over 500 members in that 2 years. So it was pretty full on, but and that was the difficulty is getting your system set up from a small little club where you can just keep it all on scraps of paper and it sort of works, mm-hmm. to when you get above about 300 members, you have to have a proper system. You have to be a little bit sort of corporatized almost. You have to have a an electronic fund system. You have to have a bank, you know, because you're managing much larger funds. That means you have to train all of your committee members in proper corporate management and conflict of interest management and financial management. So it was a challenge. That was the most challenging thing, was the growth. But it was wonderful. You know, we got to support all these new beekeepers as they entered the this wonderful sort of hobby. It was lovely.
That's great. So you obviously have dealt with a lot of new beekeepers, or people that are just starting to beekeep, or people that are thinking about going into the beekeeping world. Any tips for those new beekeepers?
Yeah, look, the one thing I wish people had emphasized more when I was starting is start with two hives of exactly the same type. And I never got that, and I never understood how important it was. And that's why I'm so glad that we have the training apiary, because you can explain to people why that's important and show them why it's important. But it's kind of weird when you talk to people and you say, look, it's actually heaps easier if you have two identical hives side by side. You'll actually have a much easier time. And it sounds wrong, because, you know, how can two hives be easier than one? But actually, in a lot of ways, they are. So that's the one thing. And also, just learning to relax, which always sounds crazy, because, you know, you're opening a beehive. Like, it's not something you'd normally be relaxed doing. But I find, as I've gone on, and that's the nice thing about the new beekeepers, is we get them in the really full gear, and we show them nice, reasonably placid hives, and get them relaxed, and we find that then flows through into their beekeeping, where they do, because they are more relaxed, their bees respond to that, they pick up on their mood a lot more, and they're able to then start on the right footing. Whereas when I first started, I remember the first time I opened a hive for an inspection myself, I was as nervous as when I'm, you know, about to step onto the mat for a competitive fight. It's about the same level of nerves the first time I opened. And I've always sort of remembered that when I'm talking to new beekeepers, to try and get them to just chill out, calm down, put really full gear on. Don't start gloveless. Get all your gear on so you're not worried at all about being stung, and make sure you do your zips up. The number of times I've done an inspection and I've sort of had the hood open and one sort of snuck in, and all of a sudden you're not calm anymore. You're like, whoa, 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 whoa.
That gets me to think about what do you think is the funniest moment in your beekeeping journey?
Absolutely, the funniest was the first time we tried to harvest honey, because, like I said, I wasn't particularly interested in honey, and to this day I'm still not. So we left it for a full year, which is good, which is what you're supposed to do, and we had a full box sitting up there. And we harvested it. And we had, I think, about like a dozen jars lined up. And we thought, oh, that'll good. We'll get, you know, a dozen jars of honey. We'll give it to some friends. I remember extracting, and we would have gotten 30 kilos of honey out of this full box, full eight-frame, full-depth box. And we'd filled up the 12 jars. And then we're like, oh, hang on, this honey tank, you know, the strained honey tank, it's not going down at all. It's like, oh, this is bad. So we ended up, we filled up saucepans and every Tupperware container we had, and it was just ridiculous. Honey just sort of went everywhere, all through the kitchen. It's funny now, but at the time we were going, what are we going to do with all of this? We ended up having to go and get, you know, big pails from Bunnings and just fill them up, which is what we should have done the first time. But that complete explosion of honey, that was the funniest thing. And probably the other second funniest was the week after we moved in the stingless beehives to the Speaker's courtyard in Parliament. It was a really strong colony, and they went really gangbusters. And they started to create a budding colony inside one of the doors of Parliament. Aww. And we were sort of, this is not good, because Parliament, everything is heritage listed, and you're not allowed to change anything, and you're certainly not allowed to pull open a door to get a colony out. So when they started to bud into this colony, we're going, oh, all girls, no, you've got to get out of this door. We managed to sort of eventually encourage them out of the door and then seal it up with just a little plug. But that, we nearly had a second colony establishing in the actual Parliament building itself. And It would have been cute, but they were worried. They're saying in winter, what's their chance of survival? I said, oh, zero. This is an external door. They would have been fully exposed to a Canberra winter. They wouldn't have survived. It would have been bad.
Yeah.
So I hate killing bees, and I hate bees dying because of any sort of carelessness on my part. So yeah, but it was very cute and very funny, sort of workshopping this with, with the speaker of the house, and also seeing just how much they love their little stingless bees. They've really almost adopted them. It's so cute.
So how long has the native stingless bee been in the Parliament House for now?
Oh, since October.
October. Okay. And
Yeah,
they
so sorry, it was late. Yeah, late September, early October is when we moved them in from memory. So, so they're not that long. They're going. Yeah, they're going much better than expected, which has been surprising and wonderful. They're very.
I've seen your videos of you extracting honey. How was that?
Well, that was strange. I mean, it's really fun working with native stingless bees because I can really see the point to using them for pollination now because they're just so much easier to manage and they tolerate being confined so much better than European. They're actually moving three hives of European bees onto a top of a building on the weekend. And it was just such a fraught exercise. And as soon as you release them, it's just they just go for you. They're really angry. Whereas, yeah, they really just want to kill you as soon as you release them. Whereas the natives were just lovely. As soon as we opened the hive, they just had a little peek out, went inside again, had a bit of a think about it, came out, and then just started working, and it was lovely. But the harvest was, it was fun because you're not in a suit, you're really close to the colony, you're really in there with the colony, and oh, I really enjoyed it.
Can you tell us the story of the native bees? Because many people will say and will cringe at you having a beehive of stingless bees in the cold area. Can you
Yeah.
explain to the viewers and to the listeners too that what is the plan with them?
Yeah, so a lot of people have pointed out and they were very concerned. And it's lovely that they were concerned. They were the this species, Tetradegula carbonaria, they cannot survive in a cold environment. So the furthest south they can survive is around Bega, which is on the south coast near Canberra, but they certainly can't survive up in the mountains here at all. So what we were doing is we were moving in a very heavily insulated hive in a design called Hive Haven. So Hive Haven designs are really lovely. They're heavily insulated, and the nice thing is also they've got a front entrance that's easy to close off. So we were able to close off the entrance and get these bees in, manage them. But then what we'll do during winter is we're going to overwinter them in Sydney in Government House. So they're actually the New South Wales governor, who is himself a beekeeper and already has some native stingless bees very successfully at Government House. We organise with them to be the overwintering site. So as soon as the weather starts to dip and cool, we'll pack these bees up, move them up to Sydney, and that'll be their digs, a beautiful harborside digs for the rest of the winter, and then we'll move them back in spring. So it's also testing out that migratory beekeeping approach, which we do with European bees, but we don't do it really with our native bees. And I can really see the potential with this hive design because it is easy to transport. It's quite light. They tolerate being moved pretty well. And we have a big need for both pollination for fruit crops in the open, but also for more enclosed crops in large greenhouses throughout the country. And I don't think people realize how big some of these greenhouses are. They will be, I think, pretty much perfect for native stingless bees. There have, interestingly, when I started, no one was, I didn't think anyone had kept bees, stingless bees in Canberra over winter. And I found out later on that's not true. Quite a few people have been experimenting using heavily insulated boxes and also bringing the homes inside, the hives inside their homes and having just a short tube out. And that's worked. That's worked really well. People have been quite successfully overwintering their bees. So in the fullness of time, we might even try and find a way to overwinter them in Canberra. The only downside is one of the plans some of the local MPs had was they were thinking, well, I wouldn't mind having this in my office with a little tube out to the outside. It would mean drilling a hole in the wall, which needs so much approvals, it's crazy. But yeah, it's a nice story how it came about because it was actually the local member for Hive Haven, They'd won an award. They'd won an innovation award, and the local member saw this, and off his own bat, he knew that the department were keeping bees at Parliament, and he contacted the department and said, could we do this? You know, could we actually move this? Could we try bringing them into Parliament? And we were like, actually, that was about the time we were thinking about what next would we do, and it was a perfect timing. He came on board and was really proactive. And as a result, we made the offer to them, said, look, let's talk this through. We can bring this in under our license and bring them in. And we did. And it's worked really well. They've been really productive, which has been fantastic and surprising. So, yeah, they've gone better than expected.
That's good. And you know that I had stingless bees, not one only. Many a hive of them here in Adelaide, and I overwintered them very well, and they survived, and they're back in Sydney at the moment, but I'm thinking about getting maybe more, like four of them like that in spring. They can mate and, you know, create something, because they survive well here. Just need to create that microclimate for them.
Yeah, and actually I saw how to do it the other day, because I've been working with the Slovenian embassy. They wanted to bring in one of their hive designs, which is the Slovenian AZ hive.
Oh,
and
yes.
It's really cool. It's a cabinet style hive with you it's like pulling the frame, you pull them out like books on a shelf. But the whole thing is inside a cabinet, and it's inside this little hut, basically. That would work, I think, very well, because that's how Anne and Jeff have a whole bunch of hives set up at their home to keep them cool, to protect them from extreme heat. They have them set up in a shed that they can control the climate. But we could do the exact opposite here. We could just keep them in a heated room or a heated area, and see how they go. So that would be the next thing we'd like to try, would be to see how well they tolerate living indoors, with just a little exit to the outdoors in Canberra over winter.
That'd be fantastic.
It would be fantastic. If it works, it means we could potentially bring the species almost anywhere.
Yes, that's it. If that works, definitely. And that would be a great thing to have. I think a lot of people will cringe at that, but that's okay. I have another question for you. What do you think you're not good at in terms of beekeeping?
Oh, No, I'm not good at managing my time. I'm not good at saying no to things, and I tend to get overloaded, and this is my partner's really useful, because she'll usually yank me back and go, you've taken on too much. You can't do all of this. You're saying yes to too many things. You need to, you know, cut back to things you can actually achieve. And that's my bad, you know, that's my thing. I tend to say yes too much and try and do too many things, and then not have enough hours in the day. Usually I can get away with it. I don't actually sleep very much, so that sort of helps. But it means that I do, that is my bad habit, is taking on too much and sometimes getting overloaded and then getting worn out.
And on the other side, what do you enjoy the most about beekeeping?
I really enjoy trying out new and different hive designs. Yeah, so different hive designs and understanding how human cultures have kept bees. It's just, that's the thing I enjoy most of all, is when you travel, I've been all through Africa and seeing how they manage it, seeing Ethiopia, how Ethiopians, because bees are really central to their religion. A lot of churches have a beehive in the entrance to the church, and it has a lot of spiritual significance, the honey from those hives. But it's been a big part of their culture for forever. And also, seeing how different cultures and the Slovenians, the Europeans, it's been really fun helping the Swiss ambassador establish his hives, because he used to be a commercial beekeeper back home all through uni. That's how he sort of put himself through uni to some degree. But then he got a job where he couldn't keep bees. When he moved to Canberra and he heard about the hives of Parliament, he was like, oh, I can do this again. So he's got a couple of flow hives, but seeing, he'd never seen bearding because he's in a cool environment. So the first time they bearded, he sends me a picture and goes, you know, what is this? I've never seen this before. They're not swarming, they're doing something else. And I had to explain, you know, hot weather management for bees in heat waves for him. And he'd already read up a bit. He already had a water source for them. It was good, but it was really interesting. He'd literally never seen bearding before, even though he had been a commercial beekeeper. But in Switzerland, where, you know, you just don't get hot conditions.
Do you get to, there's so much question coming through my mind. I think the first question that's going to have to lead to the other questions, which is, how did you get into having beehives at the Parliament House?
Necessity. So I had one hive at home, mm-hmm. and they swarmed. They swarmed onto my partner's favorite dress. And I was about to be murdered, because if they had started building comb on her favorite yellow dress, I would have been killed. So I had to move them on really quickly. So I established a second hive. The rule she had imposed on me, though, was that I was only allowed to have one hive at home. So I talked to my office and where I was working, and they were like, at Oricon, and they were like, well, you know, let's talk this through. We organized a way that we could keep them on one of the balconies, and we started keeping them. But then we had to move offices, and we had at that stage two hives. And unfortunately, we weren't able to keep them in the new building. It was really interesting in terms of building design. A lot of buildings, you cannot, there's no safe roof access. So you can't have solar panels, you can't have gardens, you can't have beehives. So it was a really interesting thing, because, you know, Oricon does a lot of building design. It was an eye-opener for them, going, oh, we should think more about this, about integrating natural things into our buildings, which they're now doing really well. Yeah. And but we had to move our hives. So we had them in a temporary apiary in someone's backyard, basically. And around about the same time, a major report had come out from Parliament about beekeeping. Mm-hmm. And we talked to Parliament and said, look, what do you think? Could we do this? And I said, yeah, this is doable. It took a lot of negotiation, a lot of management, a lot of management plans. But after a while, they moved them in as an experiment, and it's worked. We've never looked back. We're 3 years in now, and they've sort of, the people that work in the building love them. The nice thing is, it's a really high-pressure building. It's a very, you know, difficult job to work in that building at all, even if you're not a parliamentarian. People need those gardens to chill out, and that's how they relax. They go for a walk, they walk through the garden to sort of, you know, wind down a bit if they're having a really bad day. And I've been finding increasingly a lot of people go just to sit next to the hives and just watch the bees work.
Wow.
Just to calm. And they find, some people find that really calming, and it's been really good for a few people for that. So it's really nice. At the same time, that's a management challenge for me. I have to make sure that those hives will always be easy for people to be around, and that, yes, I can never have crankies.
Yeah,
so that's the main thing. And so, like you saw when we inspected, they got a little bit tetchy when we had the hives open, but to actually be around them and to stand next to them, they're totally fine. So that is my sort of, my limit bearing is they must always be easy going to presence of people near them.
Yes.
We don't encourage that. We don't tell people to go do that, but we recognize that people are doing it anyway, and we manage that as best we can.
Yeah.
We won't guarantee no stings, but so far, the only time we've had a sting was someone standing in front of the hives trying to take a selfie while standing in the path of the bees. So far, we're good.
I got a sting in my hand, but I was down without any gloves, so.
You were keeping without gloves, so yeah. And we had a queenless, hive.
Yeah, that's right. That, you know, when I went to runs, I was very lucky to go around the gardens in the Parliament House.
Yeah.
And the gardens are well designed, and there's a lot of flowering going around different time, and having beehives so close and going around those trees will create that hum for the people working there. And yeah, you can go and chill out under those trees, next to those flowers, and I find this, yeah, great. That's awesome. Sorry.
No, it's lovely. Those gardens are a real masterpiece, because they're maintained with almost no pesticides.
They
don't use, the gardeners are really, really clever. They use integrated pest management. They breed their own predator species. So they manage that through really light touch. They have almost no chemicals. I mean, they sometimes use a small amount of non-residual chemicals for a very specific small time, but effectively, it's completely chemical-free. It's a very, very well managed garden, so it's really lucky. And like you said, there's always something flowering. There's always forage for them.
Mm-hmm.
So even though we're not running them for honey production, we are actually doing pretty well in that sense.
Yeah, that's amazing. What I found is, as soon as you had those hives there, you just say that, you get the Slovenian embassy and the Swiss embassy contacting you. Do you have more embassy contacting you on a regular basis to get hives?
Yeah, and we've got three embassies now in Canberra that keep hives. Actually, no, four. The Belgians just started keeping hives.
Oh, really?
I think the French are about to start as well. But we've got the Swedish, mm-hmm. Swedish embassy. They keep top bar hives.
Yes.
We've got the Swiss embassy. They keep two flow hives, and mm-hmm. they're loving them. And the Slovenian, they keep standard Langstroth, and they were the first people to start keeping hives mm-hmm. Because it's central to Slovenian culture, beekeeping. But they've just brought in their AZ hive, which is I'm really excited actually to try. It's just to learn how to manage this sort of hive with them. They've got very experienced beekeepers giving them advice. So the embassy staff do most of the work.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the nice thing is I don't have to, and that's like I said before about mm-hmm. not getting caught up in things, making sure that I don't say yes to too many things. There are a lot of embassies that want to start, but we've actually been getting the local bee clubs involved now. The
okay.
bee club involved to help people out, help them set up. But the three embassies that I've helped them set up, I mean, they're managing themselves now, so they're they don't need much help from me. It's just fun, a whole bunch of group of friends now that I would probably never have met otherwise. That we catch up every now and then. It's really lovely.
That's great. That's great. It sounds like you're a bit of a toy boy, not this like toy. And it reflects in your interest into the different beehives available. But is there anything that you are very curious about at the moment, apart from the AZ, to play and have your hands on?
I think learning like a completely new species with the stingless hives, that's mm-hmm. been really fascinating because they just, while there are similarities between a stingless bee colony and a standard European colony, in many ways, particularly in terms of the management, they're so different. And just learning that has been really intriguing and interesting. And I think like we were talking before we went live about we've been integrating online sensors into the hives.
The buzz box.
Yeah. So that's an AI-enabled sensor that sits in the hive and listens. It uses audio, so it listens to the hum of the hive and uses sort of like a Google Translate almost to decode the hum.
Mm-hmm.
That's still, it's working, but it's constantly being upgraded and developed. And it'd be really fun to do that to stingless hives to see, because the part of the development of that, we're involved in the initial development of doing really detailed recordings of the sounds inside the hive. And honeybees use sound to talk, to communicate a lot as a colony. But it'd be fascinating to see if native bees do that, because they do make a noise, generally not something we can hear particularly well, but mm-hmm. it's definitely, there's a lot going on in terms of audio inside pretty much all hives. It was really interesting when we're doing the high definition recording, listening to ourselves moving around. It changed my beekeeping a lot. So listening to ourselves moving around the hive and touching things and removing frames and hearing how loud that is when
yes.
you've got sort of your bee ears on with the sensors, with the HD recording, when you hear how comparatively loud you are, it's just crazy. It's like you're hitting the side of the box with a hammer, even mm-hmm. though you're just moving a frame and you think you're moving really quietly. It actually sounds like tearing and smashing inside the hive. And so that made me much gentler and more gradual in my movements. And I noticed immediately there was an improvement in how well I could inspect without upsetting my colonies.
Yeah.
Just by being so much gentler.
Do you have any, or is the general public has any access to those sounds?
Yeah, we have them on an online database. If you look up the Open Source Beehives Project, They've got the full, because it wasn't just us. There's, I think, six other research groups also recorded sounds, and they're, because it's an open source ethos to what they're doing, they've got them freely available to download. They are really big files, though. I mean, I think we ended up with 220 gigabytes of audio recording.
Wow.
So, and that was just us. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff there.
Wow, that's amazing. And what's the is the buzz box available to people, to the public?
You can buy it right now. It was crowdfunded through one of the, I think it was Kickstarter or Indiegogo.
Yeah.
But yeah, you can just buy them now off their website. And yeah, people seem to like them. I've been enjoying working with it. It means that I was in Japan for judo last year, and I was able to sort of remotely check on the hives and check how they're going through winter. It detects queenlessness quite reliably, which is really handy.
Right.
And the other fun thing was we noticed that the colony makes a particular hum when they're getting ready to swarm, which was a fairly new discovery. And it means that it will give you a warning saying, hang on, you should check. I think they're getting ready to swarm. And you get about a week's warning, which is nice because it means you can organize a nuke, you can do a split, or you can set up a catch box, you know, whatever your system is that you manage, how you manage swarming, you've got that time to respond. And that's a really valuable thing. The next iteration, they're currently working with the US Department of Agriculture to find ways to detect external threats to the particularly pesticide impacts. So when the hives have been hit by a pesticide event, which happens a lot in America, unfortunately, to see if there's a detectable signature for when the colony goes into sort of, oh, hang on, we're losing too many workers, you know, we've suddenly got a large death event, to see if that can be detected. Because again, being able to respond to that quickly, either close the hives and move them away from the pesticide source, or you know, or take some action, that's really valuable.
Okay, well, I think that's going to lead me to my last question is, no, actually, I have two more questions. One question is, what did you wish you knew before starting beekeeping?
Yeah, I wish I knew how much help there is out there. If you know, you don't have to do it on your own, and how much more enjoyable it is and easier it is to do if you have like an experienced mentor. It took me a little while to get a mentor. But when I did, you know, it was fantastic. So, yeah, Carmen Mitchell-Pierce from Canberra, Urban Honey, wonderful person to sort of ask questions of. Very experienced, third-generation beekeeper, so very experienced. And, yeah, she had a really good, she was a real help. So that's the main thing, yeah. Just knowing how useful and enjoyable it is to be able to connect with a more experienced beekeeper and get their advice. Because you don't have to get a lot of time out of them. It just means you can send them a photo off your phone to say, what is this? You know, is this normal? Is it not? Yeah. When I started out, that's the main thing. Like, you know, is everything okay?
Yeah.
And now I do that for others. So it's actually kind of nice. A friend of ours, she's always wanted to do beekeeping. So with her wife, her wife organized for me to move a hive in secretly. So yeah, it was pretty funny actually. There was a hive in her backyard for months and she didn't notice.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and then on her birthday we were able to do the big reveal, and she loved that. Yeah, so it was good.
Wow, how do you not realize there's a hive in your backyard for 4 months?
Because her wife did most of the vegetable gardening.
Yeah.
But it was funny. Classic engineer, you know, right next to the hive, like walking near them and just never noticed that two extra like boxes had just appeared, it's pretty funny actually. We do joke about it to this day, how long it was before she noticed that there was actually, you know, I had two nucleus hives that I moved in before we joined them together to create her main colony. So it's going really well.
That's good, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I think I'm gonna lead to my last question, and it is, where do you see yourself in 3 years?
I hope I'm still beekeeping at Parliament. I think that'd be really fun. But I would see myself as having slowly built up more of a sideline of pollination. So that's what I've enjoyed doing, is learning how to do pollination in a more systematic way.
Mm-hmm.
I help the I'm doing I run the pollination for a small organic orchard. Actually, it's not that small, an organic orchard just on the outskirts of Canberra. So it's stationary beekeeping. I don't move or migrate the hives at all. I'm very conservative in how much honey I take. And they supply the really top end vegetables and fruits and berries for the 5-star restaurants here. It's really nice. Yeah, it's a really nice little orchard to work at. But yeah, I think doing more of that would be fun, time permitting. I think also in 3 years, we're going to see a lot more really big advances in artificial intelligence. And I'm really excited to see where that goes. I think that'd be really interesting to have a much more of a light touch monitoring system where you don't have to open as much to monitor the bees quite, or you don't have to intrude as much to monitor them on a much more systematic way. I think because of disease control, you still have to inspect. You always have to inspect. I say that to everyone at least 6 times a year. But it'd be really nice if you had more of that early warning, it would flag to you need to inspect now. Something's going on. Or so that's where I'd see myself. More of that AI integration into the hives. But yeah, still showing people new ways to keep bees. It'd be fun.
Oh, that's great. Well, I have to say thank you so much for being part of
No
Beekeeping, and I'm going
worries.
to talk to you in the next 3 years.
Sounds good.
Thank you again, and I will leave actually links of the buzz box down in the comment boxes. Any type of links that are useful and we've talked about today. And yeah. Okay.
Wonderful.
Thank you so much.
See you later.
And see you later. Bye bye.
Everything good.